We want to continue where we left off last night, discussing the gifts. And if you'll recall last night that we, I had just finished sharing with you the order in which I believe that the gifts relate to one another. And that the giver being the one who is uniquely conceptual, the ruler gathering concepts all the time and coordinating them, the teacher loving to gather the information and then proving whether it's true or not, and the prophet taking all of those details and putting a logic to them. And once he's convinced it's the best way to go, he is the one who initiates and persuades people, this is what you ought to do. And the comforter is the one, and by the way, the prophet is the one whom God uses to initiate function. The top three being conceptual in nature, the prophet being the initiator. That's why the prophet wants to control the situation. And in controlling it, he or she is sure that they can guarantee that it'll be done right. Because what's important to them? That something is done right. The comforter creates that atmosphere. And I believe that the gift that is above and below your gift are the two gifts that you have the most natural affinity for. Now you get up to the giver, and he has the most natural affinity for an exhorter and a ruler. Because the giver is what? He is the start of a process. What's the exhorter? He's the one that completes a process. And it's so amazing to note how that a giver is very seldom prone to give to a ruler or a teacher or a prophet. The giver is most strongly motivated to give to an exhorter. Why? Because the exhorter is always producing results. And a giver doesn't like to put his money somewhere where he can't see results. And there's just that affinity, and the giver is locked into ministry. If you have an idea, yes. That's what I'm talking about right now. That's what we ended up on last night, right? No, sir. The order that I taught it is the order in Romans. Right. Right. And I'm working right now on all the backup, because that order is substantiated in about four or five places in Scripture. But before I get into all, I know the teachers would be frustrated if I just popped it out and said, here's what it is, without all the details to substantiate it, and they would be fearful of heresy and a whole bunch of other things. So all you teachers that don't want to buy this order, just forget it for now. And later on, I'll answer all your questions. And so, what is so exciting is, of all things, I left that one overlay at home figuring we're going to pick up here. But I want to share something with you. You've got your notes there. The giver is the conceptual person. And the ruler is the one who gathers things and communicates them. The giver is nonverbal, and the ruler is a verbal person. The teacher is the one who loves to gather concepts. The prophet takes all that of the teacher, puts the logic to it, and what does he do? He's the verbal one. And he's the one that will persuade, because the teacher, who wants people to comprehend the information, their greatest joy, however, is in the gathering of the information. The comforter seeks to create the atmosphere. Now, I call those first two administrative functions. Then the next two are really management functions. And the last three are functional. And the comforter creates the atmosphere for things. The server takes all of the details and does it, and the exhorter is the one who completes it, and the exhorter is a verbal person. Your ruler and your prophet and your exhorter are your three big talkers. And, you know, if you can't, don't seem to ever be able to turn them off. That's kind of a little hint. Your teacher and your prophet and your servers are your intricate detail people. Now, all of us give attention to detail. But they're the ones that cannot comprehend how things can function without the importance of detail. Now, there's no big deal if there happens to be a husband and wife both in the same category. So far, I haven't met any. Yes. Well, I'm not saying you won't. But our needs, in other words, there tends to be a conceptual person marries a functional person. Because, and you see, we're incomplete in ourselves. When God says the two shall be one, when God took the rib out of Adam, it made him incomplete. And a man is an incomplete entity until he is married, and then the two become one. And that's why you hear so many comments, opposites attract. It isn't opposites. It's the vacuum in my life that is the complement to my life. Now, what happens, those strengths that I sense are complements after marriage become my greatest source of irritation. See? It's my greatest struggle. I need it so desperately. But by the same token, when I am wrongfully exercising my gift, then I'm really like a fish out of water. Now, start to come into a situation, be a ruler, and you come into a situation and you just want everybody to, you just want to kind of coordinate things, and here's somebody, and he's a talker. And the last thing this person who's got a broken heart wants to hear is somebody rattling on all the time. Whereas what they need at that point is a comforter to come in there and understand and help them feel better. You see? And when it's like when two people go out to witness. How many times have they said, you know, one of you do all the speaking and the other one keep quiet. You be the prayer support. And I don't think most of the time they've known why they've said that. But you know why it is? If you're a prophet and the Lord opens the door for you to approach that person, that approach is going to be very direct. It's going to be very forthright. And if you're a comforter, you'll start to feel uneasy at how direct this person is. And oh boy, I wonder if it's hurting this person's feelings. Well, if the comforter in that point in time tries to come in and buffer everything, he or she is negating what the Holy Spirit is going to do, because the only way that that person should be approached is the way the prophet is approaching. If the prophet decides to try to be a comforter, he's going to be like a fish out of water. And this is where we can develop a tremendous confidence that the way one individual really strongly feels he should go about a situation, for him, that is the way he should go about it. And any other way is going to be wrong. That's why I believe if the members of a board of a church do not understand one another's spiritual gifts, you have built into the board concept the disintegration of the organization. Because each one of those individuals feel very strongly that the way they look at this thing and the way it ought to be done is the right way. And each one autonomously does this. And so I have found, by and large now, and I haven't found the exception, but it could happen, and I wouldn't be frustrated with it. But by and large, I found a husband married to a gal in one of the other categories. And the category that's missing in the marriage relationship represents the greatest bulk of their frustrations in the marriage. For example, I am a conceptual person. My wife is a functional person. The biggest frustrations in our home is the management of things. when I'm home. Because let's deal with things in general, honey. Let's not get down to all the specifics. Now, Carol has a place for everything in its place. And when she is able to control the situation, it just runs. The nice atmosphere, the whole thing. The conceptualizer comes and likes to be a little bit more fluid. And so Carol will say, well, honey, you know, if you would just lay out for me what you want and how you want things done, and get it organized, then I'd be able to function without the frustration. Honey, I'll get to organize it eventually. Now, you know what that means? This is what really excites me. I see a whole new dimension of material through this. I believe that the vacuum is where God comes in. That's where we get the Trinity again back together. And where we don't have it together, why, that's where both of us have to be dependent on the Holy Spirit, because our two lives don't complement each other in that one area. And that's where the Lord will come in and take those two things and put them together. Now, how to effectively approach each gift. I believe when we understand what makes a person tick, what their frame of reference is, we will quit misunderstanding so many things. Most of the things that cause initial beguilement between people is a person's reaction to the strength of that person's gift. Now, when we see the gift functioning the way God intended, it's beautiful. But when it isn't the way I do it and someone else tells me this is the way it should be done, then we react. With the giver, don't rush or expect to communicate beyond the realm of the essential and relevant. Do not interpret a hesitancy to communicate as disinterest or indifference. Now, with them, you just get to the point, say it, that's it. They don't want you to go on. See, the giver doesn't like chit-chat. The prophet doesn't like small talk. It's very frustrating to both of them. We rulers who like to kid around, tease. To the prophet, it borders on lack of spirituality. They'll start throwing the verses about frivolity. A whole bunch of things at you, see. Now, there's a difference in frivolity and a sense of humor. If you don't have a sense of humor, I feel the Lord had to have a sense of humor to have made me. Okay? My wife would agree with that. Now, the ruler, get to the point first, and then be prepared to add relevant details to substantiate the point. Do not interpret his long explanation as he thinks he knows it all. Now, my greatest complaint with Carol was, honey, you are too detailed. That used to really irritate me. We made a list of things one time. Negative traits that upset us about the other one. And then we'd look over at the quality and see what quality God wanted to build in us. Well, I enlisted about 6 or 7 for her. The only one I remembered was too detailed. And I looked over there, and there's that quality of thoroughness. She underlined on my list, bullheaded, dogmatic, rigid, inflexible, stubborn. And, you know, when she underlined those things, it almost blew my mind. Because I thought those were qualities of mine. I thought that was the way God made me. Now, you see, to be that way in the right context with the love of the Spirit is a very good quality. But if the one who loves you the most is being forced to respond to what you thought was a terrific quality, the way we're going about expressing it is not of the Lord. Carol today, it is just absolutely amazing. See, she used to start right here and go all the way around the world to get to her point. And I'd get antsy and I'd try to guess where she's going. And I am sure on many occasions I figured out exactly where she's going. And since I figured it out, she switched stories midstream. She still won't admit it. But you see, the reason she kept drawing it out was because as soon as I got the point, oh, I got it, she'd lose my attention. So the only way she'd keep my attention is to try to be Sherlock Holmes. Drag this suspense story out, you know. Honey, why don't you get to the point? Once she knew that if she got to the point, she'd still have my undivided attention, the threat was over, and she'd come out and she'd say, okay, I'll tell you what it is, and she'll tell me. And then I'll say, okay, now explain it. Tell me all about it. Well, I'm not sitting there holding my breath and getting upset anymore. And now I know where she's going. What can I do? With that concept, I have a place to hang the information. Prior to that time, she's pouring in all this information, and I'm still trying to figure out the concept. And it just works so beautifully now because details are important to her. But the details she wants to talk about are feelings. Do you know if I apologize to Carol to say, honey, I was wrong, will you please forgive me? Means absolutely nothing to her. Do you know what the next thing she'll say? Well, do you really understand how that made me feel? And I used to say, well, sure I do, honey. She said, well, how did I feel? And I'd try to fake it. And she'd be in tears. See, you really didn't understand. And if you really didn't understand, guess what she thought about my apology? Worthless. And so now, before I ever apologize to Carol, I don't come through with a, honey, I'm sorry. I was wrong. Forgive me. I wait until the Holy Spirit really shows me how it affected her, and with my apology comes the insight as to how I know she felt. And when I apologize like that, she knows it's for real. And it just eliminates all kinds of conversation. Teacher, be prepared to share. I'm going blind here. Be prepared to share all the details. Do not interpret his inquisitiveness as a lack of belief in what you're saying. And they'll constantly be asking questions, constantly asking for information. Tell me more. What are you doing that for? And we'll explain that. And they just can amass tremendous amounts of information. And they love it. Prophet. Come with your conclusions validated to stand up against his persistence to challenge your point without taking his directness personally. See, the prophet's aware that he's blunt or she's blunt and people react. And it kills them inside because they don't want people to react. If people could just see their heart, how sincere they really are. And if because they're direct, you take it that way, they watch the reaction. You may take up offense. You may think that they're nosy. You may think that they don't have any business. You know, mind your own business. You don't need to tell me what I did wrong. Do not interpret his bluntness or abruptness as rejection. The comforter, honestly communicate how much you value his feelings. Be patient and provide time to enable him to express his feelings in words. Behind those feelings are tremendous concepts. Do not interpret his silence as he doesn't care. The server. Each of these words are really important. I mean, there's tons of insight into almost every phrase here. Server, stay sincerely involved in communicating until he knows precisely what and how a responsibility needs to be done. Do not interpret his disgust that he's giving up. And the exhorter, be patient and open to allow him to make a move when ready. Realize he's cautious in not wanting to miss any facets in guaranteeing results. Do not react to his hesitancy in committing himself to your ideas. Now, Bill Gothard does a couple of things when he shares the gifts that I think are worth sharing with you. They're not printed. You'll have to write them down. But the one here is, the idea is that here are seven men on a church board. They get together to organize a church. And they want to give their input as to what would really make a good church. And here's, in essence, what they would do. The prophet would say, want well-prepared sermons exposing sin, proclaiming righteousness, and warning of judgment to come. And the server would want practical assistance to each member of the church to encourage him and to help him fulfill his responsibilities. Look for things to do. The teacher would want in-depth Bible studies with special emphasis on the precise meaning of words. Detailed information. The exhorter would want personal counseling and encouragement for each member to assist him in applying scriptural principles to his daily living. The giver would want generous programs of financial assistance to missionaries and other ministries. The ruler would want a smooth-running organization throughout the church so that every phase will be carried out decently and in order. And the comforter will want a special outreach and concern for the precise and varying feelings of individuals with a readiness to meet their needs. Now, it is so interesting when you start seeing what the breakdown is of the gifts in your church. You may have already thought of some other people while you have reacted to them, and you know without a shadow of a doubt, now I know what they are. And now all of a sudden that situation becomes a tremendous strength that you really appreciate. Now another little thing he does here, which I think is cute, is he takes a situation where a family is out eating, and someone drops the dessert. Or maybe they're at home, I don't know which it is. And here's how each, if there were seven in the family and they all had a different gift, here's how each one might respond to the accident. The prophet would say, see, that's what happens when you're not careful. So he'd want to correct his life. The server, here, let me help you clean it up. They want to fulfill that need. They want to do something. The teacher, the reason that it fell was it was too heavy on the one side. They want you to understand. See? The exhorter, next time let's serve the dessert with the meal. See? They're concerned about those results. And the ruler would say, Jim, would you get the mop? Sue, please help pick it up. Mary, help me fix some other dessert. And I got it backwards here. The comforter would say, don't feel badly. It could have happened to anyone. Trying to relieve the embarrassment. And the giver, I'll be happy to buy a new dessert. And to meet that tangible need. Now, you may have some questions here you'd like to ask, and yes.
Larry, you were talking about each of us forming our gifts and our motivations. Would you speak to the need or your belief about the need for us to perform all of the seven gifts, even though we would do it from our basic motivation?
Okay. For example, let me speak to two things. One of the reasons a lot of people will say, well, I think I have more than one. If you go back to that delegated list, the further down the scale you get, the greater capacity that gift has to comprehend the other ones. The further up the scale you are, the harder it is for you to realize what makes those people tick. The further you get down into the functional, so that by the time you get to the exhorter, he can basically handle it all. So it isn't from the most important to the least. As a matter of fact, the ones up at the top are the ones with the more tunnel vision. And the further down you get, the broader scope of function. So that an exhorter is usually the one who feels, well, I think I've got them all. I've heard that said many times by him. Well, I feel like I've got them all. And usually what he's saying is, well, before I can ever complete something, I've got to know the concept. I've got to get the thing coordinated. It's got to have the right details. And there's got to be a logic to it. You certainly got to have the right atmosphere. And the exhorter is the one that'll move in what? See? Come alongside, move in and get anything settled. If there's a little riffle over here, he'll move over here and get that whole thing smoothed out. Why? So we can keep going to the results. And he'll get the people who will do it, the servers, and say, come on here, give me a hand here. And his whole reason for doing this is to see that result is completed. And so I believe that's one of the biggest causes for the misunderstanding, and we start thinking in terms of external function. But our gift, which is the frame of reference that we really function and operate at, I may actually do any one of these actions, plus many more that are in Scripture. See, I teach, but I don't enjoy teaching, per se. My motivation for teaching is that I feel that if we're ever going to reach the church, we have got to start putting some of the blind spots back into what we're doing. Most of what the church is doing is not wrong. Most of what the church is doing is with blind spots. It's not what they're doing that's wrong. It's what they are not doing. It's what they've left out. For example, turn with me to Isaiah chapter 61. I believe the whole spectrum of the message of the church is given in Isaiah chapter 61. And we're told here that he has sent me to preach glad tidings to the meek. Now, what's that? That's the gospel. And then you get down here to verse 2, and it says, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God. What's that? That's eschatology. That's the second coming. And to comfort all that mourn. Now, I believe that that basically makes up the message that the church has been purporting over the last 40 years. You know why I think that? Because during, I call it the World War Syndrome, if you were absolutely sure that Christ may come tonight, I mean really believe he's coming tonight, any minute. I believe he can come any minute. But if you noticed over the last 25 years, it isn't quite that urgent in the voice of the preacher. It might happen. But I'm telling you, when I was a boy, he is coming tonight. And you may go to sleep tonight and not wake up tomorrow morning. And it'd be gone. Well, if you were a preacher and you really thought Hitler might be the Antichrist, the end of the world is on its way, and you've got a chance to preach your last two sermons today, what would you preach on? You'd preach on the gospel to get as many more into the kingdom as you can, and you'd try to tell them what's about to happen. And then the way we comfort those that mourn is we visit those in the hospital and handle the funerals. But now let's go back and see the whole spectrum. The Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings to the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted. That message has been missing. To proclaim liberty to the captives. There isn't any sin that you may have that God can't free you. and to open the prison to those that are bound. And those messages, by and large, now it's not exclusive, but by and large, generally speaking, have been a vacuum and a void in the church. We haven't read Isaiah 58 that says, the fast that God has chosen is to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, to let the oppressed go free, and that you break every yoke. So what's happened? The church has developed as severe a psychological problems within our organization as society has developed psychological problems. And because of that, it has driven us back to Scripture to see what Scripture has to say about these problems that are so overwhelming that we cannot avoid them. There are just too many broken hearts, too many broken homes, too many hurt children. And it has forced us, because as I showed you earlier in the seminar, we're in the third and fourth generation, and we're ripe again. But these things aren't new. Just go back 100 years and read them. First place I ever read these principles was in the writings of John Wesley. And then in Finney's revival lectures. And then in the writings of Jonathan Edwards. Because if God was using these people and lives were being changed, and there was a permanence to the change, what were these men saying? And do you know what they were saying? They were saying what we're saying now. But the message slipped away from us. So I teach, but my reason for teaching is because of my underlying goal to rebuild foundations, to help Christians see the blind spots of what they've been neglecting. Now, in order to get it across, I've got to teach. But my joy isn't teaching. I do things for people. I serve people, but I don't go around looking for something to do for people. When I do something for people, it's because I'm involved in a situation, I look it over, and I see that if somebody doesn't stopgap that right there, the whole thing isn't going to work. And I'll go over and do this, because I am more prone if there are four people standing around, and there are four blind spots. I say, Bill, listen, would you go and get this? And John, listen, how about you taking that? See, and I would prefer to stay back and keep the overview. But I can get just as excited about doing it when I see how important it is to be done in order for the whole to function. I give to people. But my joy is not in just spontaneously looking for something to give. I give from the frame of reference of once I see what needs to be given. That's when I contemplate, I conceptualize. That's why I have very seldom in my life, in fact, I honestly can't think of any, but there probably have been one or two times, that I have ever given by somebody motivating me to give. Somebody giving a sales pitch. Somebody telling a tearjerker. That does absolutely nothing to me. Because I don't give on emotion. I give on the basis of concept. How much do I have? What does God want me to give? How much do I have to give? What are God's basis for determining where to give? If I gave to everybody that asked, I'd have to borrow money to live on. So I think a thing through, and then I give. Whereas the giver doesn't have to think about it. He has an instinct. It's really exciting to watch. See, what our gift is, we don't have to try to be it. It is us. The giver, when he gives, he just instinctively sees it and gives it. That's what needs to be done. That's what needs to assist the situation. Gives no more thought to it. I may give, and after I give, I may still be running in the back of my mind. Now, did I cover all my tracks? Am I sure that that's exactly what I should have done? And I may mull that over just to reconfirm it, feel the confidence about it. I exhort people. I'll get someone alongside, and I know if I just take a little bit of extra personal time and encourage them. That's what they need. See, but that isn't my joy. I do that because I see that it's something that needs to be done. If your gift is serving, you can do any of those other things, but the reason you will be doing it is because it's something you can do. It's something I know I can do, and it's something that needs to be done, and that's what I want to do. And the server's frustrated why other people can't see what needs to be done. Why don't they do something? How long is Coy going to sit around thinking? Why doesn't he get it and do it? So I said, our whole focus of attention has got to be on obedience, not on your gift. And the most tragic thing that can happen is if you start joking about it, the other's gifts. Oh, you're a prophet. Well, you're so blunt. Oh, you're a giver. And you start minimizing, and what we're doing is nervously rejecting what God has done in a person's life. See, it's a good way to forestall somebody telling me directly what God knew I needed to be told direct. Scripture says, you know, a frank answer is always more appreciated in the end. I don't know exactly which end it's talking about, but we need it sometimes. Yes?
I'd like to ask a two-part question. I hope they're combined. You said, I understood you to say last night, that everybody gets their spiritual gift when they're born, but it's not revealed till later.
I'm saying that it takes on no spiritual dimension till they're born again.
Okay. In light of that, how do you differentiate between a person's natural ability in management or administration from the spiritual gift of that same
quality? Because all leadership is learned. If I have an ability that has nothing to do with my motivation. See, God has told every single man to love and lead. That is without any respect to personality. And every principle of leadership is a learned principle. It is something that anybody can learn. Now, those of us who tend to not be so managerial, we'll try to excuse that. Is it just, well, you can't get it all in one basket, honey. I'm a lover, but I'm not a leader. Well, God doesn't accept that rationale. Doesn't accept that kind of excuse. And that's why it isn't natural for any man to be the kind of lover God wants him to be and the kind of leader God wants to be. It's supernatural. And every one of us has to depend on the Holy Spirit to be what God wants us to be. But our abilities are the things that we do, we are able to do, or capable of doing, that is entirely different from the frame of reference that I look at things. See, it's the filter through which I see life.
So couldn't an unbeliever have a similar frame of reference? He has a frame of reference.
Oh, he has the same one, but he doesn't know it. He doesn't even know what it is. If you tried to explain it to him, he'd think you're crazy. I know many non-believers. In fact, I have started using the recognition of a person's potential gift for the Lord as a means of sharing Christ. And I'll send somebody, I'll say, brother, if anybody's got a prophet's eyes, you do. Prophet's eyes. And I'll say, do you feel that everything's logical in life? Well, obviously, of course. You think you could take any kind of problem? Now here, I've never met this man before. He is absolutely dumbfounded that I can explain to him exactly what he feels and thinks inside. And I'm telling him secrets that he may never have been able to crystallize before and put into words. And he wonders, how in the world do you know me or what is important to me and how I think when we just met? And it is a beautiful opportunity to share Christ with them. Did you ever feel that you're really here on this earth for something more important than just what you're doing? Well, what you're doing is important, but there's even something more. And I really believe it's those fleeting moments that a person expressed their gift, had no eternal dimension, but it was so fulfilling. And they may spend the rest of their life looking for it. What was it I did? How could I get back in that track? Am I dropping? No. Yes, back here.
At what age in children and so forth do you start recognizing the gifts and the different gifts become evident much earlier than the other?
I don't know if there's an age limit because it's just been the last year and a half where I feel that these handles that we've just laid out for you has made it possible with a little perception or questions to actually see and know another person's gift. There was a time when I realized it was all inside a person that I would say, you can't know another person's gift. Only that person could tell you what to think. And but see, I think what it is you see my hand. Well, that's my hand. But the thing that causes my hand to function isn't the hand. See, there's something within it that makes it function. And what we are prone to do is read the functions of the gifts and say, ah, got the gift of teaching. But that's not innately what has motivated him to teach. And God looks on the inside, and you'll find yourselves struggling all the time to get off the external things and stay away from the temptation to categorize someone without knowing what motivates them. Yes, back here.
I'm basing my question on an assumption which may or may not be correct, so correct me if I'm wrong. You inferred that obviously some gifts work better with others. Other combinations work better. Do you find that, for example, maybe two rulers aren't very efficient or might not be very efficient or make a problem?
That would be so true.
Okay. Mm-hmm. On that basis, then, how would you address yourself to within an organization when obviously there are times when two rulers, for example, I'm thinking of that because personal experience maybe, that obviously have to work together. There are problems that before I've never had any handle on figuring out what they were, but I'm just beginning to see that. Something there. Yeah.
Well, if you get two rulers, unless the love of Christ is there, you're sure that your frame of reference is right. One of the weaknesses of a ruler is to draw a premature conclusion about the overview, thinking he's got the whole overview. And explain that as the whole situation. And yet he keeps on gathering more insights and he sees some more pieces to the pie. Now, what I mean by the same gift and the two on each side, they're the ones with whom you feel like you are almost instinctively on the same wavelength with. Rather than an affinity that we get along, you're on the same wavelength. Now, you can clash with any of them, including two rulers can clash. But just as you start thinking of people who you like and you just respond to, I mean, there's just no hassle. You just kind of, it worked out almost the day you met. Well, in most cases, you're going to find they either have the same gift or they have the one right next to you. Certainly worked out in my children. Without my children knowing the gifts, asking which one of their brothers and sisters they got along with the best. In every situation, they chose the one that was next to them, closest to them. David has a terrible time with Karen, and her gift's comforting. He's a teacher. She frustrates him. All of her emotions and her feelings, Karen. See, and yet, and then so, well, which of your brothers and sisters do you get along? I get along with Sharon the best. We have more fun. David's a teacher. Sharon's a prophet. And they do. See, she's the one that'll take his input. She doesn't want to listen to his details. Yes.
Larry, you've lived with these things for years, and it's all clear to you.
Mm-hmm.
What do you say to the poor people here when we split up to go to groups? We're not sure what group to go to. In other words, what can you say anything more than what you've said.
Okay. Wait, is there someone here who thinks has their gift down, they believe to two and can't decide, and would like to talk to me in public about it? Huh? No, we'll do a little role playing here just for a little bit. You want to do that? Okay, which can't you decide now?
Between prophet and teacher.
Between prophet and teacher. Okay. Would you say that when you can't understand things or you can't get all the information, you get frustrated?
Sometimes I'll be willing to say, I'll wait until I get one. It's not a compulsion to get the information right away, but
you're frustrated till you can get it? Would your wife say that you come off blunt?
Yes.
Or she watches you get frustrated first before you get blunt? He gets frustrated first, and then he gets blunt. What are some of the things that you enjoy doing for the Lord, or what are some of the things you enjoy doing with people?
Communicating truth and helping people on a one-to-one basis with their whatever.
Okay. Now, why do you want to communicate truth?
Because it's there. Because that's a compulsion that I feel from.
I think some of your gifts are laughing with you out here. Anybody hearing what his gift is? Huh? Don't say it yet. But we'll come on and validate it. Would you say that when you share information, let me put it this way, a prophet, if he shared information, his purpose for sharing it would be to convince you you're wrong. A teacher who shares information feels that if I can get the information across and they can understand it, then they'll be able to do what they ought to do.
Are you saying that as a prophet, I'd only communicate information when I want to prove something wrong?
I'm saying when you would communicate the information, it would be to prove that they were wrong or to tell them they were wrong. And the only way that they could really see they were wrong would be for you to tell them. Whereas the teacher gets excited about the fact that if they can just understand, and if they just comprehend this truth and this information, then the Spirit of God can take over and be able to do what he ought to do. Okay. I see you said a couple of real key words right at the beginning. You said, well, I want them to comprehend truth. See, and the teacher is locked into truth. Whereas the prophet, in other words, the teacher is locked in, is this true? Whereas the prophet is locked into, is this right or wrong? And there's a difference between is something true and is it right or wrong?
What's the difference?
Well, the one's conceptual and the other's functional. See, I conceptually decide if it's true. I functionally see if you're wrong.
That issue was the thing that really made me not be able to decide, because I feel like, and others around me feel like, I see things in black and white. There are no shades of gray. Mm-hmm. It's right or wrong. I know that's not always a good.
But see, the question is whether it's really black or white, or whether it's true or untrue. There's a difference.
Well, see, if the has to be defined.
Yeah. Okay. Now, if you're not sure, see, now I think your gift is teaching, but let's just hold it in check. If you're not sure, start exercising your gift of teaching. And as you start doing it and you keep these other things out, you'll get more excited. All of a sudden, you'll sense if I start to get frustrated about something. The reason it's hard for a teacher many times to discern is because a teacher, once he's amassed information on the subject, he is the quickest to draw a quick conclusion and assume that whatever information he's been able to amass up to this point is all he needs to make his conclusion. And if he goes negative, he tends to revile a person. To revile a person is to take a fact, conclude a negative reaction, and then project it on the person. See, and rather feeling that a person is wrong about something, the teacher would be prone to feel they're stupid. I mean, how ignorant can they be? Now, if he says that bluntly, people might think we must be a prophet. But see, he is not trying to convince the person. He's trying to inform him. By the way, in case you didn't know it, you were absent when the Lord passed out the brains. Okay. Somebody else just want to discuss it? Okay. Yes.
On the comforter, if that person is very easy to project herself or himself into the situation, is there too much of a tendency to get overly emotionally involved? A comforter, say, visiting sick or visiting distress, becoming so emotionally involved in it that it literally saps them, or they find a renewed strength, or...
Any gift exercised in selfishness or without the power of the Spirit, one will overdo it and it'll destroy their motivation. In other words, the prophet can start feeling that every time he speaks, everybody ought to do something. And there's a time to speak and a time to keep silent, the Lord says. And the comforter will be the first to try to nudge him and tell him to shut up. The corresponding strength of the gift is also the most potential weakness. And that's why husbands and wives, that's why it is so essential that we look at life from the other person's point of view, or there will not come the adaptation and the acceptance that my mate is normal. And if I do not appreciate that frame of reference that my mate is normal, I believe most of the breakups in marriage are not a fundamental problem between the mates, but an underlying bitterness to God for the way he made the mate. Because you listen to them tell what's wrong in the marriage, and they're both blaming the other one. And when you listen to each one tell their own story, both of their stories sound absolutely logical and right. As a matter of fact, that man probably would be totally right if he didn't have a wife to reckon with. It's probably the way he functions in the job. And she'd be totally right if she didn't have a man to respond to. She could just be herself, and there wouldn't be a crisis. But Scripture says, once you're married comes the yielding of rights. The man hath no longer right over his body but the wife, and the wife hath no longer right over her body but the husband. And you submit yourselves. What's submission? What is submission? It's a what?
Attitude.
So you submit yourselves, to one another, what? In the fear of the Lord. And all of us will readily agree the deterioration of a marriage is when one or both attitudes go sour. And it's that attitude of submission to each other. Now, men have a greater threat of that because they think, well, if I start becoming sensitive, if I start showing deference, I'll lose my manlihood. She won't respect me. Just the opposite's true. You start showing deference, you start being sensitive, you start loving her, she'll have no problem, what? Having the right attitude, submitting, which is what it is. Back. All of us give attention to details in our own way. In other words, I know rulers that are very, meticulous individuals. See, God doesn't put any premium on disorganization because you're a ruler. And I've had to learn the appreciation for details because the Lord used the two before and then sent the freight train. And I really appreciate details. I get frustrated sometimes with them, but there are certain kinds of details that I really enjoy doing. But when I compare my attention to detail to the attention a teacher or prophet or server gives to detail, it makes my details look like nothing. I mean, my most intimate grasp of detail is a beginner for them. You watch a teacher start diagnosing a verse of Scripture. And what I would feel I did in diagnosing a verse of Scripture, I might have 4 or 5 pages, and the teacher would have 20 or 30 pages. It's like going to a Bible class I had with Dr. Hendricks in seminary. He told us guys to take this one verse and find all the insights that you could find. And brother, I went home. We had to find at least 30. And I went home and I racked my brain and I found 34. And I'm telling you, I thought I had just aced the course. One guy came back with 237. And I'm saying, that's ridiculous. I used all my brain power. Dr. Hendricks, this guy thought he was bragging, says, I found over 900 so far. And I'm going, oh, my land. See? You know what the next day's assignment was? Go back and find 30 more. I sat there, and I tried to find 30 more, and I just... And I don't think I got 60 altogether. Now, it was just the most intimate detail I could get into. So all of us have to address ourselves to detail. But the way we do it and what constitutes detail is really quite different for some of us. Yes?
What, in a nutshell, is the difference between being a prophet and an exhorter? I was sure I was a prophet. I went home and everybody said, no, you're an exhorter.
The prophet is the one who wants to initiate and convince everybody to do something. And he is a detailed person. He just won't move until he can think the whole thing through from A to Z and to find out whether it's right and whether it's logical and it's the best way to do it. The exhorter is the one who says, give it to me, I'll do it. The prophet wants to control it and see that it gets done right. The exhorter says, I'll do it, and I'll gather everybody around me to do it. The prophet is clearly an initiator, and the exhorter is the completer. The exhorter tends to be a strong people-to-people type of person. Tends to come off with he's the one most flexible to hospitality. More exhorters tend to, and comforters and servers tend to be the ones that make you feel like you've known them forever. Prophet doesn't get that response from people because his directness caused people to kind of, when he's blunt and so forth, tends to kind of only get so close in case he goes to preaching. I don't mean preaching the Bible, but telling me, because I don't want to be told all the time. Now, just don't listen to all these people telling you what you are. They may not know, you may not have been communicating much over the years, and they don't know what's going on inside.
Well, I know I'm a direct, blunt person, mm-hmm. but I'm fantastic one-to-one.
Sure. Well, lots of prophets are tremendous counselors. People will come to them because they like to give them all the information, and he so quickly can just assimilate it and put a logic to it and persuade them what you ought to do. See? Whereas the exhorter, he is not concerned about so much persuading them what to do as much as he wants to see the results. The thing that gives him his joy is the results. The thing the prophet wants to see is that you stop your disobedience, stop doing what you're doing wrong. Okay. Yes. Anywhere. Us rulers just put them anywhere. Uh, If a person's really operating out of his gift, I would say the purest perfectionist is the giver. And your next detail person is your teacher, prophet, and server. The reason the giver tends to be a perfectionist is because everything's absolute to him. Not everything is right and wrong, but he doesn't do something until he's lived all the way through it and it's established as an absolute. Now, another tremendous cause for, quote, perfectionism is guilt. If the person is a perfectionist because they're trying to compensate for wrongdoing. There's a difference in giving complete attention to detail and being a perfectionist and unable to tolerate anything that would be wrong, out of place, dirty. And I don't know how broad a scope you're talking about there. Yes. I like to think of you as a domestic engineer. That's it. See, now the question, what are some of the things that you would feel stand uppermost in the things that you do? What would people say you're known for? Maybe your daughter can answer that. Encouraging people?
I had decided, that being an exhorter.
Mm-hmm.
But, I think sometimes I'm a ruler, and sometimes I'm a teacher. I have some teachers. I don't really know what's easy.
Okay, now first of all, you're talking about all the external things you're doing rather than asking yourself, why do you teach? Now, I also mentioned that one gift tends to think they have them all anyway. See? Okay. You know why? Because, and I'm not saying you're an exhorter, but the exhorter is the one who most naturally transposes himself in any of those situations to do whatever's needed to be done to get the results. You see? And to exhort means to call one alongside and encourage and persuade on a course of action. But the motivation is to see the growth and results. That's what gives them their joy. See? Yeah. Well, that's what you do. See, my wife wants to see that all the children are emotionally stable. And as soon as one of the kids' feelings are hurt, the first thing she'll do is she'll move in and do whatever is necessary to make that child feel comfortable. See? But you would probably move in and exhort your child and explain in a practical way how if they would do these things and work them out, then you know they'd get the kind of results that you would like to see happen. That's what she does, huh? Okay? Yes.
Ever since a group of us, some years ago, heard this from Bill Goffin, a lot of the men have been confused, and I have too, exhorters and rulers. And you said you had the same problem.
Mm-hmm.
Could you delineate between those two?
Yes. I believe that when I first started writing this, the first thing that broke me loose from my chain, so to speak, happened to be what Philip said about an exhorter. If your gift is the stimulating of the faith. And so I was with Bill one day, and I read that to him, and both of us were deeply involved in wanting to see Christians grow. See? So both of us, just like that, we're both exhorters then. Now, so for 5 years, in the back of my mind, without knowing my gift, I am so full of joy in watching Christians grow. But what I was really doing was I knew there had to be a blueprint. is the word I kept using over and over again. There's got to be a blueprint. Paul had a frame of reference that he knew how to bring a Christian to maturity. I was fishing for the concepts Paul was operating under. The only way I could find it was just endless hours of personal involvement. What happened? Once I found the concepts, I lost interest in the counseling. And I shifted gears. Now, it didn't mean that now I don't like to talk to anybody. The people I like to talk to now are people who are leaders, who are laymen, who are involved in the Lord's work. You know why? Because I see multiplicity. I can spend a day talking to 12 people that are from any church at random who have a problem, or I could spend the same day talking to 12 leaders of the church that could each help 12 other people in their church. Well, see, I get really excited about that multiplicity factor, that multiplication factor. And so when that shifted, Bill felt he was an exhorter. Now, I don't think he's an exhorter. I think he's got a different gift. And but I think we were so intensely involved in working one-to-one, but after we found that, then our motivation changed. See, it really didn't change. We started discovering that really wasn't what we're that excited about. Because he doesn't like to do a lot of personal counseling. He likes to take an individual and once or twice, and if we haven't been able to resolve that thing in a very short period of time, something's wrong. There's a logical way to do things, and there's a precise way to speak things. There is a specific message that needs to be communicated. Do you know what I think he is? Prophet. And when we used to do dual teaching, he'd say to me, "Now, Larry, what are you going to say? And exactly how are you going to say this?" And I'd say, "I know what I'm going to say, but exactly what points are you going to say?" And in the back of my mind, I knew all the concepts that I had to get in, and I knew what result I wanted. Well, when I teach, I do not want people to become magnetized information. I want a person to grab the concept. If they walk out of a lecture and they say, "Oh, now I get it," I feel that I've accomplished what I need, because now that they got it, they can go back and read the manual that I wrote that explains it. See, I wrote the manual, so if you just go back and read it yourself, it'd be self-explanatory. But when I speak, I am not trying to get across a body of information. I'm trying to give us a handle or concept that once I get that, it's real simple to put all the other things into place. Which is a frustration for some of the gifts, my type of delivery. See? And the way I can encourage some of them is to go back and say, "Well, now, before you get too frustrated, I've got the outline written there. I've got the order laid out. Go back and look at the white tab and your initial manual, and I filtered all the basic points out of all my lectures and put them there in a systematic order for you teachers and prophets. And then you can start from there. If you go on into the introduction section, you'll see the Beatitudes listed there. And you'll see the principles that are related to the Beatitudes. And you can start studying from there. In this manual, under your second white tab, Successful Ministry, there's a section there called Seminar Study Methods. And I wrote that section to tell you how to use the blue book, the first blue book. See, and I wrote that because I know other people, that's what they have been looking for in order to really sense a fulfillment in their own gift. You see what I mean? And so the ruler sees an overview to things. The basic motivation of a ruler is to gather concepts, get them coordinated, and give them away. He wants to do the homework, get them done, so you functional people can use them. The motivation of the exhorter is give it all to me and I'll do it. I'm the one that will guarantee for you the most complete results. Now, obviously, for an exhorter to give the complete results and to do the right kind of job, he has to have the overview. But that's just a little portion of what the exhorter is able to handle. See, he's able to handle an overview that any ruler can give out. Plus, he can handle the details of the teacher and the prophet and all those things to guarantee that the whole thing will be completed and work.
In those 5 years that you talked to Jeff's exhortation, in your impulsive reaction to a situation, were you indignant during those 5 years or discouraged?
I was certainly indignant. Yeah. Oh, man, my gift. Oh, my gift never changed, no.
I mean, but wouldn't that have helped you identify that earlier?
No, you see what I did. The reason I think so many people initially think they're exhorters is because some point in our lives, we come to realize that no matter what I'm going to do, I have got to learn how to deal with people. So almost everyone in their life realizes their limitation in communicating or relating to people, and they start to get involved with people. And sometimes, if you just identify the exhorter, well, he works one-to-one. And maybe some prophet is just starting to exercise that one-to-one situation. He'll say, well, I'm an exhorter. When really, what he's trying to do is logically put these things together. But he's doing it by one-to-one. So my gift never changed. What happened is that was just like, and of course the other thing was, I had no frame of reference to draw from. You know, there was no other counsel, there was no other books to read, and you're working through this thing, trying to go slowly and identify it.
Did you try to hide or repress that indignation during that time because you didn't understand that was your natural or supernatural, whichever the case is?
It's not supernatural.
Reaction?
Ever since I gave my life to Christ, I've tried to repress it and keep it just between God and me. Now, it's not a matter of repressing. See, the thing we've got to face is that this old body and old nature of ours is with us till Christ comes. Or we die, and then we're given a new body. And as Hebrews 12:15 says, take heed lest any fail to respond to the grace of God, lest a root of bitterness springing up in you. And you could take any of our impulsive reactions, lest a root of indignation springing up in you, lest a root of discouragement. Be of good cheer, be not discouraged, be of good courage. Lest a root of bluntness springing up in you. You could take any of our old nature impulsive reactions. And the day we fail to respond to God's grace, out it'll come. And see, that's why I had to just go absolutely silent. And then that's when Carol would say, if eyes could kill, I'd be dead. Because my indignation would be flaring inside, and I just would remain immobile. Or I'd have two apologies to make. One to the Lord is bad enough.